फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल एसएम लेक्चर सीरीज। योर ओनली स्टॉप टू गेट ऑल द नॉलेज ऑफ फाइनाइट एलिमेंट एनालिसिस, कैडकैम, सीएई एंड मेनी अदर सब्जेक्ट्स। ऑल्सो योर वन स्टॉप डेस्टिनेशन टू लर्न सॉफ्टवेयर्स लाइक सॉलिड वर्क्स, मास्टर कैम, ऑटोडेस्क फ्यूजन 360 एंड मेनी मोर टू कम। प्लीज डू लाइक, शेयर एंड सब्सक्राइब माय चैनल टू स्टे अपडेटेड विद द लेटेस्ट नॉलेज। थैंक यू। हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू फाइनाइट एलिमेंट एनालिसिस लेक्चर सीरीज। इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू सी द शेप फंक्शंस एंड इंटरपोलेशन फंक्शंस फॉर the linear bar element, okay, using two methods. The first method is conventional method and the second method is using the property of shape function. So let's get started. Just to brush up the knowledge of the coordinate systems, okay, I have just compared three coordinate systems which we use in finite element analysis. So this first is a global coordinate system. Okay, I have shown here linear bar element just for the example purpose. So in global coordinates, the global reference origin is away from the object, okay, and all the dimensions are referred from the global reference. So the node number one location, the x dimension, since we are referring the one dimensional element, that is linear bar element, so we have only one dimension in this coordinate system, that is horizontal x. And horizontal x is positive in this right direction. So the node number one distance will be measured from the global reference origin, which comes to be x1. And similarly, the node number two distance from the measured from the global reference origin will be x2. And in that sense, the total length or extent of the element becomes x2 minus x1, where these x2 and x1 are the global distances from the global reference origin. So this is the global coordinate system. In global coordinate systems, we tend to represent all the variables with a capital letter sign just to differentiate between different coordinate systems. And then we move to the local coordinate system. Now, local coordinate system, we specifically create wherever we want to implement the element analysis. So global coordinate system is by default present in any field problem of consideration, and in order to carry out the element analysis we require local coordinates. So basically there are two types of local coordinates. One is this having a origin on the left end of the element or the first node of the element, and the second one is having origin at the center of the element. Okay, so these two are, both are basically types of local coordinates, okay, but we use them specifically. Okay, we'll see in the later stages how we use them. So in local coordinates, the origin is on the first node of the element. Since this is a two noded element, the left node will have origin. So this is the x direction. Again, x direction remains to be in the horizontal towards the right hand side. That is going to be the positive x direction. On node number one, the x dimension is zero because that is the origin point. And at node number two, the x dimension is equal to L, where L happens to be the length of element, or we can also call it as extent of element. So L minus zero turns out to be L. And in natural coordinate system, we have coordinate variable zeta. Okay, coordinate variable zeta. And in this, the origin is at the center of element, and from here the zeta calculation starts, or zeta positive starts. So zeta equal to zero is at the center of element. Okay, we tend to go till the the second node. So here the dimension turns out to be z equal to one, or zeta equal to one. And when we start from node number one, okay, here the dimension is zeta equal to minus one. So the value of zeta is always between minus one and plus one. And extent of element in this case can be given as the value of zeta at node number 2 minus value at zeta at node number 1. So 1 minus minus 1 equal to 2. This particular system is called as unitless coordinates. Okay, unitless coordinates. And we can map this system over any intricate shape. Okay, so need for this coordinate system is will be explained or will be understood slightly later in this subject, where we want to map some of the curvatures of the geometry using different kinds of elements. Okay, so for that purpose, this natural coordinates or natural coordinate system is created. So with this, now we will focus on the shape functions and interpolation functions for linear bar element. What we are going to do is we will find shape functions and interpolation functions for linear bar element using all these three coordinate systems. Okay, so let's get started. This is the same diagram which I have taken down. So this is the global reference. This is the x1, okay, value of the distance of the node 1 from the global reference and distance of the node 2 from global reference. So in other words, I can also say that this tells us that the value, that is field variable x having value x1, okay, at node 1, and field variable x having value x2 at node 2. Okay, this is what we get. Okay, this is what we get. Now there are two methods. Okay, now there are two methods of finding the shape function. So first method is using the conventional method. Okay, first method is conventional method. In conventional method, we go ahead with the behavior of element and try to form the equation. So the conventional method will tell us that u is equal to, which is the primary variable in this structural field, which is nothing but displacement. So since there are two nodes, okay, so I will include the interpolation function which has two unknown parameters. Okay, so c0 plus c1x. So this is going to be my interpolation function. Okay, this is going to be my interpolation function. Now I will use these boundary conditions which are given, okay, at this point of time. So the boundary conditions are like at x equal to x1, okay, at x equal to x1, I know that the value of primary variable is also u1. So here the values of primary variables are u1 here and u2 here. Okay, since this is having 1 degree of freedom, okay, this is having 1 degree of freedom at every node. So at every node I have only one primary variable, which is displacement. Okay, I have only one primary variable, which is displacement. So it is basically the displacement in x direction. So at x equal to x1, my u is u1. Okay, x equal to x1, my u is u1. So if I replace these values back into the above equation, what I can do is I can rewrite that equation using these values. So u will become u1, c0 will stay as it is, c0 plus c1x1. Okay, c0 plus c1x1. So this equation I get. So let me just call this as equation 1. Similarly, at the second node, at x equal to x2, okay, the value of primary variable is u2. So if I put these values back into my original equation, okay, I get u2 is equal to, okay, c0, okay, not c2, c0 plus c1 x2, okay, c0 plus c1 x2. Now I have got these two equations. Okay, I have got these two equations. So what I will do is, okay, I will first subtract these two equations. So I will say equation 1 minus equation 2. What it will give me? It will directly give me u1 minus u2. I will get rid of the c0. Okay, so I will have here c1 x1 minus x2, and in turn what I will have is, in turn what I will have is c1 is nothing but u1 minus u2 divided by x1 minus x2. See, our aim here is to find out these two unknown parameters. Okay, these two unknown parameters, when we will put the values of these unknown parameters back into this equation, okay, eventually we will get the complete interpolation function, and we will also get the the corresponding shape functions. So that is our aim. So now this new value of c1, if I put in any one of the equations, okay, I will get the the next thing is, okay, as we have done, the next thing is to find out the value of c0. So c0 eventually turns out to be this, okay. So it is like u1 x2 minus of u1 x2 plus u2 x1 plus u2 x1 is nothing but divided by x1 minus x2. So this is what c0 and c1 I get. Okay, when I put back these values into this equation again, okay, so eventually I get this. So minus of u1 x2 plus u2 x1 divided by x1 minus x2, okay, divided by x1 minus x2 plus c1 multiplied by, so c1 is given by u1 minus u2 divided by x1 minus x2, okay, multiplied by x. So when I simplify this, okay, when I simplify this, simplification is not difficult. Okay, I already have common denominators, so I just have to multiply this x inside, simplify, okay, multiply this x inside, simplify. What I get is, okay, I'll directly write the simplification, x2 minus x divided by x2 minus x1 multiplied by u1, okay, plus x minus x1 divided by x2 minus x1 multiplied by u2. So when I when I write this in a required form, okay, when I write this in a required form, so it is in this particular format, n1 u1 plus n2 u2, where, okay, n1 is nothing but x2 minus x upon x2 minus x1, and n2 is nothing but x minus x1 upon x2 minus x1. Okay, so this is what n1 and n2 we get. Now this is the shape function for the linear bar element in global coordinates using the conventional method. Okay, using the conventional method. I hope you are following. And this particular thing is a interpolation function. This is what? This is the interpolation function. And these two are what? These two are shape functions. Since linear bar element has two nodes, there are two shape functions. Okay, there are two shape functions. So the second method is using the property of shape functions. So let's say I have formed these equations x equal to x1, x equal to x2. So what I will do is I will bring everything on one side. So x minus x1 equal to 0 and x minus x2 equal to 0. Okay, now my shape function, okay, my shape function, which is L, okay, is proportional to whatever equation I get with the independent variable and the node location, okay, at node 1. My shape function is basically a geometry function. So my shape function is proportional to x minus x1. My shape function is also proportional to the equation which I get at node 2. So that is x minus x2. Okay, so in other words, I can say my shape function combinedly is proportional to their multiplication. So x minus x1, x minus x1 and x minus x2. So if I have to define the constant of proportionality, I will use a shape factor, okay, multiplied by x minus x1 multiplied by x minus x2. Okay, when that happens, okay, now my aim is to find out these shape factor for finding the value of shape functions individually at node number 1, at node number 2. So now I will again use the condition that is at node number 1. Okay, at node number 1, I know that x is equal to x1 and shape function is n. Okay, so at node number 1, shape function is n1. And when I am considering the property of shape function, so summation of shape function should always remain 1. So if I am going to consider value of shape function at node number 1, so it has to be 1 because its value at node number 2 is going to be 0. So the distribution of n1, okay, distribution of n1 is linear with its value changing from node number 1, its value is 1. And as we go towards node number 2, the value decreases to 0. So at any point of time, the summation of shape function is always 1. Okay, that equation is maintained. So when I'm doing this, okay, so this equation I will have to rewrite. So this equation I will rewrite only by deleting this x minus x1 term, because if I include x minus x1, the equation will give me 0. Because if I have to apply the property of shape function, okay, in order to apply the property of shape function, the node number at which we are trying to identify the shape function value, that equation we have to omit from the calculation. So I will say delete this x minus x1 term, and after rewriting this I get n1 is equal to sf multiplied by x minus x2. Now it is just to find the values, so I will put all the limiting values. At node number 1, value of n1 is 1. So shape factor I can find out easily. At node number 1, value of x is x1. So this is x1 minus x2. So eventually, my shape factor turns out to be 1 upon x1 minus x2. And that is the reason why my n1 turns out to be x minus x2 upon x1 minus x2. Okay, x minus x2 upon x1 minus x2. Now as you can see here, if I commonly take a minus sign outside, okay, I can rewrite this as, let's say, x2 minus x upon x2 minus x1, and it is one and the same thing. Okay, it is one and the same thing. Now similarly at node 2, okay, similarly at node 2, what happens? X is x2 and n equal to n2 equal to 1. So at node 2, we'll have to delete this term. Okay, otherwise again I will not have any equation to solve. So at node 2, I'm going to delete the equation that I got at node 2 and rewrite this in terms of the limiting values. So n2 is shape factor multiplied by the only term remaining, that is x minus x1. Now I will put the values. So 1, that is what we got, okay, shape factor, and at x equal to at node number 2, the value of x is x2, so it is x2 minus x1. So my shape factor is the shape factor 1 upon x2 minus x1, and eventually n2 is given by x minus x1 upon x2 minus x1, which is the same thing which we have got over here, x minus x1 upon x2 minus x1, and the interpolation function remains to be the same. So this u is nothing but n1 u1 plus n2 u2. Okay, n1 u1 plus n2 u2. So I hope you have understood how to find the shape function in global coordinates, okay, for the linear bar element. okay, shape function in global coordinates for linear bar element. Okay, now we'll move ahead and try to identify the shape function at for the local coordinates. Okay, again using both the equations. Okay, again using both the equations. So okay, and just to explain the distribution, okay, before we go to the next phase, okay, just to explain the distribution, let us say I have, okay, this is my node number 1, node number 2. So how the N1 distribution is, N1's distribution is this, it's a linear variation. So this is the value of N1. It's 1 at node number 1 and 0 at node number 2. Okay, exactly opposite to this is going to be the distribution of N2, whose value will be 1 at node number 2 and 0 at node number 1. Okay, so this is going to be the distribution of N2. Okay, and if I have to showcase the distribution of this interpolation function U, then I can showcase it something like this. Again, a linear, okay, this is a straight line, a slanted straight line, okay, something like this. So this is nothing but my U. Okay, it has some value U1 on node number 1, some value U2 on node number 1. So these are my shape function and interpolation function distributions in the global coordinates, okay, on the linear bar element. Now we'll see the next method, that is the local coordinates, okay, shape function for local coordinates. So first we will use the conventional method. A conventional method. So in conventional method, okay, we have the equation again of the same kind, that is C0 plus C1x. Okay, the only thing is we have different extents for elements now. So now what we have over here is at x equal to 0, okay, we know that u is equal to u1. Okay, u is equal to u1. So when we will put that back into this, okay, I get u1 is equal to c0. Okay, u1 is equal to c0, because x equal to 0 will give me nothing over here. Okay, so 0 into c1, that is 0. So eventually I get c0 as u1, and when I use at x equal to l, okay, u is equal to u2. Okay, what do I get? I get u2 is equal to u1. I have already got as, let's say, c0 I have already got as u1. So u1 plus c1 into l. Okay, c1 into l. So what I get as c1, okay, when I simplify, is going to be u2 minus u1 upon l. So when I put both of these values, okay, into this equation, okay, both of these values into this equation, that is these two. Into our main equation, what I get is u is equal to u1 plus u2 minus u1 upon l multiplied by x. So when I try to simplify, okay, it will be u1 plus u2x minus u1x upon l. Okay, when I further simplify this, okay, I will bring this l on the numerator over here, do the summation, take out the common terms, and just try to simplify. Okay, just try to simplify. So what I get in turn is u is equal to, I get something like this, 1 minus x by l multiplied by u1 plus x by l multiplied by u2. okay, which is again of the form, which is again of the form u is equal to n1 u1 plus n2 u2, where n1 in local coordinate systems for linear bar element is given by 1 minus x by l, and n2 is given by x by l. Okay, n2 is given by x by l. Okay, so this is the difference. Okay, now here we were getting it in terms of all the global coordinates. Now here we are getting the shape function and interpolation values in terms of the local coordinates. Okay, so coordinate system changes, the values of shape function and interpolation function changes. Okay, the second method is using the property of shape function, using the property of shape function. So when I use the shape function property, okay, I know that my shape function, okay, see how I write now, okay, x equal to 0, this is the equation that I get. I will bring everything on one side, so x minus l equal to 0. So now I know that my shape function should be equal to both of these equations, multiplication of both of these equations, so that is x and x minus l. Okay, now at node 1, okay, I will use the property of shape function, so n equal to n1 equal to 1 and x equal to 0. So what I will do is I will delete this x from the above equation, so my equation will become n1 is equal to shape function or shape factor multiplied by x minus l. Now I will use the limiting value, so 1 is equal to shape factor multiplied by 0 minus l. So my shape factor eventually becomes minus 1 upon l. Okay, minus 1 upon l. And when I put this back into the equation of n1, so I get minus 1 upon l into x minus l. So it becomes, when I simplify, 1 minus x by l. That is the value of n1 that I get. Okay, similarly I can do it for node 2. So at node 2 I know that the shape function is n2 and its limiting value is 1 and x value is l. So what I will be doing, I will be deleting x minus l from this equation so that I can find the n2. So my n2 becomes shape factor multiplied by x. So shape factor finding is very simple. It is shape factor and value of x is l. So my shape factor is 1 by l and my n2 is nothing but x by l. And my interpolation function remains to be same, that is u equal to n1 u1 plus n2 u2. And I can very well showcase the distribution of shape function in a similar manner. So my distribution doesn't change. Okay, in coordinate systems, the distribution is something which doesn't change. It remains to be linear. As you can see, all the equations, okay, in local coordinate systems, the equation is what? N1 u1 plus n2 u2. So what is the order of n1? The highest power of the independent variable x is 1. So that is linear behavior. Okay, so if my element is linear, my shape functions are also linear. Okay, so that's what the property turns out to be. So this is distribution of n2. Okay, and similarly I have the distribution for the interpolation functions. So this is going to be u1, this is going to be u2, and this is going to be distribution u for the entire interpolation function. So I hope you have followed, okay, how to find the shape functions for local coordinate system for the linear bar element. Okay, now we'll move quickly to the natural coordinates. Now in natural coordinates, okay, I know that the origin is at the center. Okay, origin at the center. So we'll first use the conventional method. So in conventional method, okay, I have u is equal to c0 plus c1. Now the variable for natural coordinate is zeta. So I know that at zeta equal to minus 1, okay, u is equal to u1. So that will give me, okay, if I put these limiting values inside, u1 is equal to c0 plus, this is c1 into minus 1, which is nothing but c0 minus c1. Okay, and same at zeta equal to 1, I have u equal to u2. So that will give me u2 is equal to c0 plus c1 into 1, that is c0 plus c1. Okay, that is c0 plus c1. So now I have these two equations and these two unknown values to be found out, so I can easily find them out. So when I do the subtraction, okay, when I do the subtraction and simultaneously subtraction and addition, okay, I will easily get these two values, as c0 turns out to be u1 plus u2 by 2, and c1 eventually when I simplify turns out to be u2 minus u1 by 2, okay, u2 minus u1 by 2. And when I find the, when I put these values back into the original equation, okay, original equation, and simplify, so I have the situation u1 plus u2 by 2 plus u2 minus u1 by 2 the whole multiplied by zeta. Okay, when I simplify this, I get my shape functions in the form of 1 minus zeta by 2 multiplied by u1 plus 1 plus zeta by 2 multiplied by u2. So here it is again of the same form as u equal to n1 u1 plus n2 u2, and my n1 over here is 1 minus zeta by 2, and n2 over here is 1 plus zeta by 2. Okay, so I hope this is not that difficult to identify. Okay, and when I'm going with the property of shape function method, okay, I will be bringing everything on one side. Okay, I will be bringing everything on one side. So let's just say, I will write here zeta plus 1 equal to 0, and here I will write zeta minus 1 equal to 0. Or you can do it in any way. You can bring this on zeta on this side, or you can bring the constant on the left hand side. Okay, so I know that my shape function is going to be equal to the shape factor multiplied by both of these equations. So it is zeta plus 1, zeta minus 1. Okay. Now in order to find out the shape functions, okay, in order to find out the shape functions, okay, I will use the boundary conditions at typical nodes. So I know that at node 1, okay, shape function n1 is 1, and also value of zeta is minus 1. The value of zeta is minus 1. So I will delete this zeta plus 1 term because it is going to give me 0. Okay. So if I put zeta equal to minus 1 here, keeping this equation, then the equation will turn out to be 0. So I will have to delete that. So delete zeta plus 1, okay, and retain the equation. I get n1 is equal to shape factor multiplied by zeta minus 1. So eventually, when I put the limiting values, so n1 is 1, shape factor multiplied by zeta value at node number 1 is minus 1 minus 1, so eventually my shape factor becomes minus 1 by 2, okay, minus 1 by 2, and my shape function n1 can be rewritten as shape factor, that is minus 1 by 2 multiplied by zeta minus 1. So if I take that minus sign inside, okay, if I take that minus sign inside, it will become 1 minus zeta by 2, okay, which is the same thing which we have found out here. Similarly, okay, I can do it at node 2, and node 2 will give me n equal to n2 equal to 1, value of zeta is plus 1, so then I will be deleting the next term, okay, that is zeta minus 1, otherwise it will give me a 0 value, so zeta minus 1 will be deleted. So my n2 becomes shape factor multiplied by zeta plus 1. When I use the limiting values, n2 is nothing but 1, shape factor multiplied by 1 plus 1. My shape factor turns out to be 1 by 2, and my n2 turns out to be 1 plus zeta by 2. Okay, 1 plus zeta by 2. And I know that my interpolation function is always n1 u1 plus n2 u2. Okay, my distribution of shape function inside the element still remains intact. It is still linear in the same manner. This is the n1 distribution. Then I have distribution of shape function n2 in the element. And on the similar lines, I have the distribution of interpolation function in the element. Okay, that is u, something of this kind. So this is u, this is some u1, some u2. Okay, I'm not saying it will be exactly as it is. Okay, whatever values of u1 we will get, that is not known, whether u1 is greater or u2 is greater, but whatever is that, it is going to be straight line distribution, so linear behavior. So I hope you have understood the shape function distributions and finding shape functions in all the three coordinate systems, that is global coordinates, local coordinates and natural coordinates for one dimensional linear bar element. Okay, so if you like this video, please hit the like button. Okay, if you want to watch more such interesting contents, okay, please subscribe to my channel and don't forget to press the bell icon. Thank you very much, and I'll see you next time.